Welcome back. You know, most of us know someone with diabetes. Sadly, it's a very common condition. The most common form of diabetes is type 2. However, 1.2 million Americans are living with type 1 diabetes, which is found most in children and young adults. The Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation has led the search for a cure for type 1 for over 40 years. And joining me to talk about their efforts is the organization's executive director, Mary Lynn Hsu. Welcome.
Thank you for having me.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you here to talk about a condition that so many of us know someone who has diabetes. It seems to be so common.
That's right.
And most of us are sort of familiar with the people who have the type 2. Mm-hmm. Often it can be controlled through diet and exercise and so forth. And they can come off of certain types of treatments.
Mm-hmm.
But with type 1, that is not the case. You can't prevent it. There's no cure. Talk a little bit about what causes type 1.
Sure.
Do you know?
Yeah, so what happens with type 1 diabetes, you're absolutely right. There's not anything you could have done differently to prevent it. You couldn't have made different diet or lifestyle choices to prevent it. And in fact, what's happening is that the immune system is attacking the insulin-producing cells in the body. So the immune system is making a mistake and attacking something that it really shouldn't attack, mm-hmm. and makes the body incapable of producing insulin, which we need in order to turn food into energy.
Right.
So we don't know 100% why that autoimmune attack takes place. We know that there is a genetic component. So if you have a relative with type 1 diabetes, you have a higher incidence rate. But then there's also an environmental trigger, or perhaps a series of triggers that take that genetic component into fact, mm-hmm. but it also there's these environmental triggers that can cause the disease. So you could be a twin of someone with type 1 diabetes and never develop the disease. So it's more than just the genetics,
yeah.
and it's more than just the environment. It's sort of a marriage of the two.
Wow. And the thing about it too, Mary Lynn, it can come on sudden. And you'd be fine one day, and then all of a sudden you're having these symptoms. Talk about what are some of the warning symptoms of this type of diabetes.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. It can come on quickly. And what's scary is that the symptoms can appear very flu-like, in fact. And so especially this time of year during flu season, we can sometimes hear stories that we hate to hear, where people are being misdiagnosed, where children are misdiagnosed, being told, oh, it's just the flu. You know, in fact, that's what happened to me. I was diagnosed when I was 3 years old and had exhibited flu-like symptoms, and my parents took me to the pediatrician, and unfortunately the pediatrician, you know, didn't know. Of course, this was a while ago,
yeah.
but he said, you know, just drink Gatorade and she'll be fine, and things got worse and worse. So unfortunately, it is important for people to be aware. And so flu-like symptoms, but especially an increased thirst and increased urination. Those are two of the biggest telltale signs. There'll be weight loss oftentimes, and a smell of sweetness on the breath. The body's sort of trying to get rid of that sugar, and so a lot of times you can smell it in the urine or in the breath of
that's
undiagnosed.
That's really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And you were three when
that's
you were
right.
diagnosed. And I think one of the big misconceptions you all talk about is that people just assume when you say Juvenile Diabetes Foundation,
right.
that type 1 only affects juvenile.
Right.
But you can be a young adult. You
Absolutely.
Can be in your 20s on up to 40.
Yes, and even older than that. In fact,
yeah.
we know of people being diagnosed in their 60s. So it's certainly less common, but you're absolutely right. This is thought of as a childhood disease, but that's really a misconception. It is often diagnosed in childhood, but then those of us diagnosed as kids grow up. And then, like you said, there are a lot of adults being diagnosed as well. And so that's actually part of the campaign that JDRF is going to be doing in the month of November for Diabetes Awareness Month. We have a hashtag that says T1D looks like me. And so the idea is to show that it's not just kids, it is kids, but it's also everyone else that is affected by the disease. So
yeah.
you'll get to see, if you follow that hashtag, all different people from all different walks of life that live bravely with type 1 diabetes.
And when you said live bravely, that is such the case, because this is a very difficult disease to manage.
That's
all
right.
day long, you're constantly monitoring something, aren't mm-hmm. you? Talk a little bit about how it is in the treatment and how do you go about managing type 1 diabetes?
Yeah, it is. It's such a challenge. And I think what is difficult is that unless you or a loved one lives with the disease, most people really have no idea. You know, because you look at someone, a child or an adult with type 1 diabetes, and they look fine. And type 1 diabetes won't keep them from doing anything that they want to do, but it will make it much more challenging, right? So all the time in the background, that person or that child's parents are doing all kinds of math, really. It's a lot of math involved. So it's this constant balancing act. What you're trying to do is imitate what a healthy pancreas does on its own, which is give the proper amount of insulin for whatever you eat. So when you're trying to imitate that, it's a very imperfect science. I wish it was that if I took the exact same amount of insulin every day at the exact same time, that things would just work right. perfectly. But unfortunately, it doesn't work that way because there are so many factors on this kind of balancing act. So you have carbohydrates are what you're counting because that will raise your blood sugar. So anything you eat, you have to count the number of carbohydrates, which you can imagine, you know, for people that have done Weight Watchers yes, or something like yes. that, it's hard to count all that
it
stuff.
Is. It
and
is.
Then when you think about doing it in this context, it could be life or death. You have to count correctly because that's how you're dosing your insulin. And you can also imagine doing that for a child, mm-hmm. trying to measure every little, you know, sip of juice or goldfish cracker that goes in their mouth. So you're trying to balance that. But then on top of it, there are other factors. If you are stressed, that can affect your blood sugar. If you are going through a growth spurt, if you're getting sick, if it's really hot outside, there's all of these different things that can affect it. And so it's different from day to day, and it's different for every person.
Absolutely. And I would imagine if you are the parent of a school-age child,
right,
somebody has to do that while they're in school. So you have to make sure that you're definitely in contact with their teacher.
That's right.
And so forth.
Yeah, it's a huge responsibility for those secondary caregivers. And what's really exciting is there are some really cool advances in technology that are happening. And so I always love telling people about, I wear a continuous glucose monitor. And so that's a device that is measuring my blood sugar every 5 minutes, and it's wirelessly transmitting that information to my phone, and it will alarm if my blood sugar goes too high or too low. And so for a school-age child, what's great is that information can be happening for that child in real time, but mom can also be getting an alert on her cell phone at work saying, oh, Jimmy is, you know, his blood sugar is getting low, and then she can call the school and sort of react remotely, which is such a huge increase
yes.
in quality of life. You
so
know.
There have been some strides made.
Absolutely.
And the Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation is definitely continuing every day. Like I said earlier, you want to make sure type 1 becomes type none.
That's exactly right.
Are donations your main source of income? At this point, you definitely could use some folks to help out in that respect.
Yes, absolutely. So yeah, all of the money we raise is going to fund this important research that we're doing. And there is a huge gap, unfortunately, there's a huge gap between the amount of money that we're taking in currently, primarily through events. We just had our walk to our JDRF1 walk back in September. And then we have a big gala that happens in the spring. We have our ride coming up next weekend. So we do a lot of events and then lots of donors that are so generous. But even still, unfortunately, there's a big gap yeah. between what we need and what we would like to be able to fund. And it's our vision that we would create a world without type 1 diabetes. And we think that the way that will happen is by delivering sort of a continuous stream of improvements, right? So that every year I would be able to look back and say, gosh, my life living with type 1 diabetes is so much better now than it was a year ago, until eventually there's no type 1 diabetes at all.
Wow. You are such a great spokesperson and a wonderful person to come on and tell us all about type 1 diabetes. And we do hope that we will see the day when there is type none
diabetes. Right.
Thank you so much, Mary Lynn, for being here, and the best of luck to you.
Thank you so much.
I want to also thank my earlier guests from Hope Force International, Jack and Sherry Minton, Chuck Dubby, and Susan Batson. And of course, I have to always thank you for watching. Really do appreciate it. I'm Tawanda Coleman, and I'll see you next time on the Plus Side of Nashville.